Good evening. I'm Judy Woodruff on the NewsHour tonight. 1 year on, women in Afghanistan struggle for basic rights under the brutal Taliban government, a year after the chaotic U.S. withdrawal. Then, election battle. Congresswoman Liz Cheney faces steep opposition in Wyoming's Republican primary after becoming a vocal critic of former President Trump.
Liz is as conservative a Republican as you will find. When she's called not a Republican, it means she won't bow her knee to Donald Trump.
And changing guidance. The CDC loosens its safety recommendations for COVID-19, which precautions Americans do and do not need to take under the new rules. All that and more on tonight's PBS NewsHour.
Major funding for the PBS NewsHour has been provided by...
It's the little things. The reminders of what's important. It's why Fidelity dedicated advisors are here to help you create a wealth plan. A plan with tax-sensitive investing strategies. Planning focused on tomorrow, while you focus on today. That's the planning effect from Fidelity.
And with the ongoing support of these individuals and institutions, and friends of the NewsHour, including Leonard and Norma Clorfine, and Koo and Patricia Ewan. The William and Flora Hewlett Foundation. For more than 50 years, advancing ideas and supporting institutions to promote a better world at Hewlett.org. This program was made possible by the Corporation for Public Broadcasting and by contributions to your PBS station from viewers like you. Thank you.
I'm Stephanie Tsai with NewsHour West. We'll return to the full program after the latest headlines. Former President Trump's personal lawyer, Rudy Giuliani, is now a target in a criminal investigation in Georgia involving the 2020 election. Prosecutors notified his lawyers today. They have convened a special grand jury on attempts to overturn the state's election results. Also today, a federal judge ordered South Carolina Senator Lindsey Graham to appear before that grand jury. Graham said he will appeal. The U.S. Justice Department says it will oppose releasing an affidavit used to justify a search of former President Trump's home in Florida. News outlets wanted the document released, but federal prosecutors said today it would compromise their investigation. The search focused on classified records taken from the White House. The Taliban marked 1 year today since they seized Afghanistan's capital, Kabul, and took power in that country. Fighters and supporters paraded in the streets and celebrated what they called great achievements under their rule.
We are feeling very happy. We always had a vision of free and prosperous Afghanistan, and that is what we fought for over the past 20 years. Today, and as we see the result of the struggle, it's like a dream come true.
The Taliban's rule has also seen mass hunger and severe restrictions on girls and women. We'll return to this after the news summary. China's military launched new drills around Taiwan today after another U.S. congressional delegation visited the island. The five-member group met with Taiwan's president, led by Democratic Senator Ed Markey. They left later in the day, and Beijing condemned the trip. An earlier visit by House Speaker Nancy Pelosi sparked days of Chinese war games. In Kenya, Deputy President William Ruto has been declared the winner of last Tuesday's presidential election. The Electoral Commission's chairman says Ruto got just over half of the vote. Other commissioners question the results. Meanwhile, supporters of Ruto's opponent, Raila Odinga, protested. Police fired tear gas as crowds burned tires in the streets. Iran is denying any role in the stabbing of writer Salman Rushdie last week. The Islamic Republic had called for his death in 1989 over his novel, The Satanic Verses. Today, a foreign ministry spokesman suggested the author has only himself to blame for Friday's attack.
Salman Rushdie exposed himself to popular anger and fury through insulting the sacred of Islam and trespassing red lines of over 1.5 billion Muslims. We don't see any other parties who should be blamed or condemned, except for Rushdie himself and his supporters.
The U.S. State Department called Iran's claim despicable. Rushdie remains hospitalized in western New York State. A court in Myanmar convicted ousted leader Aung San Suu Kyi of new corruption charges today. That tacked on 6 more years to her earlier prison sentence of 11 years. Suu Kyi has been detained since the military overthrew her elected government in February last year. There's word that American basketball star Brittany Griner has appealed her 9-year prison sentence in Russia. It comes amid talks that could lead to a prisoner swap. Griner was arrested last February for having vape canisters of cannabis oil in her luggage. India today marked 75 years of independence from British rule, and Prime Minister Narendra Modi vowed to transform his nation into a developed country in the next 25 years. Modi made that pledge during celebrations in New Delhi. He said he'll work to rescue millions from poverty.
We have to make India a developed nation in our lifetime. The youngsters of my country, when India celebrates 100 years of independence, you will be aged 50 to 55 years, which means the golden period of your life, the 20 to 25 years of your life, is the time to make the dreams of India come true.
Modi's opponents say his Hindu nationalist party has undermined democratic freedom since taking power in 2014. Back in this country, Defense Secretary Lloyd Austin has tested positive for COVID-19 for a second time this year. He says he has mild symptoms and is quarantining at home. Austin has been fully vaccinated and boosted. Oregon's Chief Justice fired all 9 members of the state's Public Defense Services Commission today over a severe lack of public representation for hundreds of defendants. The American Bar Association reports Oregon has only 31% of the public defenders it needs. It is the only state to rely entirely on contractors for public defenders. The New Mexico medical investigator has ruled that last year's shooting on the set of the movie Rust was an accident. Actor and producer Alec Baldwin fired a gun during rehearsals that killed a cinematographer and wounded the director. Prosecutors are weighing whether to file charges. And actress Anne Heche has died in Los Angeles. She'd been critically injured in a car crash and was taken off life support last night. Heche starred in Donnie Brasco and other hit movies in the late 90s. During that same period, she and Ellen DeGeneres became one of Hollywood's first openly same-sex couples. Anne Heche was 53 years old. Still to come on the NewsHour, Tamara Keith and Amy Walter discuss the latest political news. Why the CDC is loosening some of its COVID guidelines. As he recovers from a violent attack, we examine author Salman Rushdie's lifelong fight for free speech.
This is the PBS NewsHour from WETA Studios in Washington and in the West from the Walter Cronkite School of Journalism at Arizona State University.
The Taliban takeover of Afghanistan 1 year ago today sent the nation into yet another spiral of turmoil. The chaotic withdrawal by the U.S. and NATO allies triggered a frenzied and disastrous evacuation as tens of thousands of desperate and fearful Afghans swarmed Kabul's international airport in an attempt to escape. The Taliban claimed to be different this time, making tall promises of an open, inclusive Islamic government. Over the coming days, we'll look at the Afghanistan left behind under Taliban rule, 1 year on. We begin with the plight of Afghan women and girls who've had their freedom snatched away, once again put under the Taliban's harsh rule. Special correspondent Jane Ferguson reports.
I remember that day I woke up and I was about to go to a mathematics institute that I was going because I was trying to take the entry exam for universities, and I was in.
For many women and girls in Afghanistan, August 15th is a day impossible to forget, especially for those like this girl who dreamed of an education, a career.
I was really interested to just one day work at the United Nations, and that was my biggest dream.
We are hiding her identity for her safety. When the Taliban took over the country a year ago, they promised women and girls' rights would be respected, a promise unfulfilled to this day. A recent in-depth investigation by Amnesty International has documented the devastating collapse in women's rights under the Taliban. The scope, magnitude, and severity of the Taliban's violations against women and girls are increasing month by month, it states. Within a year of its takeover of Afghanistan, the group's draconian policies are depriving millions of women and girls of the opportunity to lead safe, free, and fulfilling lives. They are being sentenced, as one Afghan woman put it, to death in slow motion. Girls over 14 continue to be banned from public school. Younger girls can still attend, but few have a realistic career ahead. Women have been forced from the workplace, and some are arbitrarily detained and tortured in prison if they break the rules, for something even as simple as leaving their homes without a male guardian.
And so these women would just go out, sometimes just to the shop, or go out to have a coffee, and suddenly they're in a detention center. What they're facing in the detention center, what we heard from these prison staff members, and then two women as well who've been detained for these charges, is that they're facing torture, including solitary confinement. They're also facing regular beating in detention.
Nicolette Waldman is the author of the report. She and her team conducted dozens of interviews with women and girls across Afghanistan.
We heard the story of one woman who was actually brought in with her newborn. She was breastfeeding the newborn at the time as a punishment for this moral corruption charge. She was separated from that child and wasn't able to breastfeed that child in solitary confinement. So just to go out to the shops, you might end up in prison. And I think this is something...
It's a form of intimidation.
It's a form of intimidation.
So it's working.
It's definitely working.
Young women we spoke with said they saw Taliban brutality up close in the months following their takeover.
They were just beating a girl, a young girl, I think she was my age, and they were just beating her so violently, although she had full hijab on, and there wasn't apparently anything wrong with her appearance. It was even hard to watch.
Many others like her have watched things over the past year they should never have had to.
Seeing your country, all the things that you've been working for, all the things that your generation have been working for, they are shattering and they are falling apart. And it was very painful for me and for my generation, because we had worked a lot. Sorry.
The emotional toll on her and her friends is massive. After 40 years of war, yet another generation has been left traumatized.
Now I feel like I'm mentally destroyed. I don't have any motivation anymore. Like, I'm not inspired to study or to do something creative like I used to. I feel like staying at home and sleeping more often, like, it wasn't like the way I was. I got dark depression twice.
It must have been very tough.
Yes,
like her, every girl we spoke with told us of the mental health battles they are now forced to fight.
It has been the toughest year of my life. It is the worst feeling, I would say. Like, not being able to study and to be deprived of your righteous education, it is the worst feeling. It is indescribable in words, and is really saddening to have not a clear vision of your future whilst you have had lots of dreams to be fulfilled.
What were your dreams? What did you want to do?
I just wanted to be involved in politics, and something that is impossible in today's Afghanistan. I wanted to be at least a diplomat. I really had that passion to be involved in politics since I was very young.
For some of her friends, life is literally unbearable.
They try to commit suicide because they got depression, like being at home for 6 whole months. I asked one of them, and she told me that she didn't know what she was doing because the kind of stress she had was overwhelming.
The Taliban have come down hardest on the women who dare to protest in the streets for their rights, arresting and holding them in prison for days of beatings. Incredibly, many still refuse to quit. On Saturday, women protested in Kabul, defying Taliban gunmen.
They're not giving up. And I think that was something that was so interesting from the interviews, was this sense of real sadness, despair, but just with that, a sense that they will keep fighting. They will, at any cost. A lot of them feel they have nothing to lose. So they would say, you know, we realized all the risks that we were facing out in the streets to protest. So we came inside, but then when we came inside, we realized we were just dying every second of the day. So we felt we had to go out and just live and live our lives and show how much this means to us.
What do these women want the White House, the Pentagon, the EU to do?
What we think, you have to call for an action that's going to influence the Taliban but not harm the Afghan people. What we think could do that would be targeted sanctions. Or travel bans for specific members of the Taliban who are involved in the systematic discrimination against women and girls.
Until there is enough pressure on the Taliban to change, women will have to endure, working hard to believe things will get better.
In this year, I realized that how emotionally, actually, fragile I was, because I was thinking that, oh, yeah, I can struggle with things and I'm strong enough, but this year, I realized that I'm really vulnerable to these mental pressures that it has for me. And I think that was a beautiful thing because this vulnerability, it taught me so many things. And I think I'm stronger than the year before. I just feel stronger and much more committed to my dreams right now.
Do you still believe in that dream? Do you think that you can still make that work?
I have never stopped believing in my dreams and in myself, but right now the difference is that I see a lot of challenges and more uncertainty than before.
20 million Afghan women are now entering a second year under Taliban rule. Their rights continue to be denied and stolen, brazenly, in full view of the world. For the PBS NewsHour, I'm Jane Ferguson.
Seven of the Republican House members who voted to impeach former President Donald Trump have already retired or lost their primary races. There has not been a more vocal GOP critic of Trump than Wyoming Representative Liz Cheney, and she is now facing an uphill battle to retain her seat in Congress. Laura Barrón-López traveled to Wyoming to speak with voters ahead of tomorrow's primary election.
My grandparents lived here.
Rachel Martinez and her family have lived in Wyoming for generations.
Yeah, we've been here. We've been building up our communities.
But if Congresswoman Liz Cheney loses on Tuesday, that could change.
I would maybe look at a different community just because of how polarized we are, just how vilified you are if you are opposite of the mainstream, which right now is the very far-right Republican narrative.
President Trump is a 76-year-old man. He is not an impressionable child. Today's hearing will
Martinez has closely watched the January 6 hearings. She's encouraged by Cheney, the committee's vice chair, and her vocal criticism of former President Donald Trump's efforts to overturn the 2020 election.
President Trump summoned the mob, assembled the mob, and lit the flame of this attack.
It has vastly changed.
Cheney's primary opponent has embraced election fraud lies. That's why Martinez, a Democrat, says this year she's switching parties to vote for Cheney.
I'm voting for somebody who I believe in the recent past has stood up for what our Constitution is about.
So ultimately your support of Cheney is about her defense of democracy.
Absolutely.
Martinez isn't alone. In Wyoming, voters can change their party affiliation all the way up to the primary election day. There are 6,000 fewer registered Democrats now than there were at the beginning of the year. And Cheney's campaign has sent information to every Wyoming voter about how they can change parties. At an early polling site in Cheyenne, every Democrat NewsHour spoke to was switching to the Republican ballot, many for the first time. Despite disagreeing with most of Cheney's conservative policies, they say her work on the January 6th committee is too important.
We got to get to the root of the problem. I completely agree with her on the January 6th investigation. I think Trump's a crook.
She is a patriot. You know, I mean, she's an American, and it seems like many others are not.
Wyoming is the least populous state, but it's also the reddest. The Democrats crossing party lines to vote for Cheney are outnumbered 4-1. Trump received 70% of the vote here in 2020, and his popularity in the cowboy state hasn't waned.
Donna Harvey was born and raised in Wyoming and now tends to her 560-acre ranch in rural Niobrara County. Like most voters in the state, Harvey is a Republican.
We're very conservative here. We're probably redder than red, I would say. And I'm righter than right.
Like other Republicans, Harvey's had doubts about Cheney since she first ran for office. She says the three-term congresswoman doesn't understand what it means to be from Wyoming.
I used to like her. I have never voted for her, even the first time she ran, because she's not from here. She's from Virginia. She's never really lived in Wyoming.
Harvey supported the former president during his 2020 campaign. She still believes, despite zero evidence, that Trump won the election. The investigation into Trump and his role on January 6th is a new reason for Harvey to support someone else on Tuesday.
I think it's just a witch hunt. Just like Trump says, they're just trying to get something on him so that he is disqualified in 2024. And I think Liz has made that very apparent also.
But there have been audits in all of those other states, multiple audits run by Republicans in some of those states, and they found no election fraud.
No, that's not right.
That's what those Republicans who ran those audits said.
Well, they're covering up stuff just because they don't want to deal with it.
Do you miss him yet?
Harvey is voting for the front runner in the Republican race, Harriet Hageman, a lawyer and 2018 candidate for governor.
And she's rock solid on ensuring free and fair elections.
Trump endorsed Hageman last September, despite her opposition to him at the 2016 GOP convention. She has since surged to the top of the polls, beating Cheney by nearly 30 points in a recent University of Wyoming survey of likely GOP primary voters.
Absolutely, the election was rigged. It was rigged to make sure that President Trump could not get reelected.
Hageman's unwavering support of Trump and the lie that the 2020 election was stolen is earning her votes from Republicans who previously backed Cheney, and even from those who know Cheney well.
This is hard for me. This is hard because I do like her very much as a person.
Crystal Sue Carr served on Cheney's 2016 campaign leadership team. 6 years later, she agrees with what Cheney has done in Congress, with one major exception. Carr believes Trump won in 2020.
Liz and I have discussed it. I don't agree with what she's doing with Trump. I like Trump. I am a Trump person still, so I did vote for Harriet.
So what do you think about her decision to serve on the January 6th committee?
I don't agree with it. And it breaks my heart, and I'm sad about it.
And why don't you agree with it?
Because I think Trump has been picked on. I think they have overstepped their boundaries time and time again with him.
Many other Republican voters who previously backed Cheney now say the same. It's impossible to support her and Trump at the same time.
She's just sitting back trying to prosecute a guy that's trying to run for president and might run for president again.
Anything with him has just been a big witch hunt.
The Wyoming Republican Party has moved more to once fringe extremes in the 18 months since the January 6th attack. Party Chair Frank Ethorn has ties to the Oath Keepers, the paramilitary group that helped breach the U.S. Capitol. Weeks after the insurrection, the state GOP Central Committee censured Cheney for her vote to impeach Trump. Months later, they ousted her from the party altogether. Republicans in Washington kicked her out, too, removing Cheney from her leadership post because she rejected Trump's election conspiracies.
6 years ago, we were sort of the standard, staid, traditional Republican party. And I think now more than anything, we're probably the party of Trump.
Tim Stubson is a former Wyoming legislator. He ran against Cheney for the Republican nomination for Congress in 2016. But now he's a vocal supporter. He says it's the Republican Party that changed, not Cheney.
Liz is as conservative Republican as you will find. When she's called not a Republican, it means she won't bow her knee to Donald Trump. The Republican Party is a very different party now than it used to be.
The lie that the 2020 presidential election was stolen is insidious.
Even as Hageman appears on the brink of victory, Cheney continues to challenge Trump, arguing that the former president and his team knew their plans around January 6 were illegal.
This is Donald Trump's legacy, but it cannot be the future of our nation.
Stepson acknowledges Cheney's chances to win the Republican primary are slim, but he's hopeful the Republican Party hasn't lost its way for good.
It's going to be a long, hard slog. 2024 isn't going to bring around a different Republican Party. It is going to have to be people in the party that are willing to stand up and start pushing again for recognition of the rule of law, recognition of fidelity to the Constitution.
Win or lose, Cheney says she will continue to warn Americans that Trump and leaders in her party who embrace him are the greatest threat to the country. For the PBS NewsHour, I'm Laura Barone-Lopez in Casper, Wyoming.
President Biden is on vacation in South Carolina, and Congress is on August recess. But the news in politics has not slowed down. Primary elections are being closely watched in Wyoming, as Laura just reported, and in Alaska. The president is set to sign the Inflation Reduction Act tomorrow, and fallout continues from the FBI's search of Donald Trump's home. Here to analyze it all are our regular Politics Monday team, Amy Walter of the Cook Political Report with Amy Walter, and Tamara Keith of NPR. Hello to both of you. It is time for Politics Monday. And as we just heard from Laura Barone-Lopez, Tam, there is a lot to talk about. We've got some big primaries this week. Everybody's watching. Wyoming, what's at stake in this race for Liz Cheney?
Well, Liz Cheney is running like someone who has nothing to lose. And in fact, she basically does have nothing to lose at this point. She made a decision, back around January 6th, a calculation that standing up for the Constitution was more important to her than her congressional seat. Because there are plenty of people, plenty of Republicans who agree with her, but none who are going to have a straight-to-camera TV ad saying that former President Trump lied and incited a riot. And as a result, she is almost certainly going to lose. There are not enough Democrats in Wyoming to help her win. And that said, she has certainly elevated herself as a voice in politics. And she obviously comes from has the Cheney name and is unlikely to disappear from the political scene, certainly.
You hear a lot, not just here, there are a lot of Democrats who are changing their registration.
And a lot of Democrats nationally who are writing checks to her. She has a very big bank account right now. She's not going to spend it all down. Even in this primary, you can't spend that much money in Wyoming. But I do think the issue of the short-term and long-term consequences is really important here. Almost everybody who voted for impeachment will have paid a short-term political cost. I think what Liz Cheney is looking at is in the future, maybe in the not so far away future, how history is going to judge her. But the other important thing, Judy, is how primaries are structured is a really important point, I think. Alaska is also holding a primary tomorrow. Lisa Murkowski, the senator, Republican senator from Alaska, voted to impeach Donald Trump. She is going to survive in Alaska because for the first time ever, Alaska now has a top four primary. Everybody runs on the same ballot. The top four vote getters will go on. The other people who voted in the House against impeaching Donald Trump, they also are from states that have a top two primary ballot. Everybody runs on the same ballot. So some of the issue is, yes, if you have a Democrat-Republican primary, that is hard to win if you go up against your party, or in this case, go up against the former president. But in these other The process is another important piece of all of this.
The process is. No question. But once again, Tam, former President Trump is at the center of what we are talking about in American politics. And we are just a week ago today, we were looking at the news of the FBI having searched the home at Mar-a-Lago, the former president's Florida estate, and the repercussions keep coming. What do we see right now as the political consequences of what's going on there?
The political consequence, or the political takeaway for me, is that this consolidated support behind Donald Trump. It proved once again that he is sort of this all-powerful figure in the Republican Party, because you have Republicans of all stripes, rather than some are just sort of ignoring the what did he have in his house and just attacking the FBI. Others are defending him even without knowing all of the facts. He is sitting back and watching people who could be 2024 primary challengers instead criticizing the FBI. And, you know, I would love to talk about the degradation of trust in institutions, but here is just example, you know, number one. Attacking the FBI is seen as completely acceptable by Republican politicians now.
Attacking it and violence, and we saw a man, you know, shot.
Right. There are consequences,
exactly.
Certainly, for this. And look, I think it may help consolidate some support around Donald Trump, maybe even help him in 2024. I don't think it's good for his party in 2022.
No.
For Republicans in this midterm election, the path to victory has been pretty clear for a long time now. Make the election about Joe Biden, who has an approval rating right now around 39 or 40%, and about the economy, in which voters are pessimistic and think that Biden and Democrats aren't doing a good job and believe Republicans would do better. That's what you make the campaign about. The more the campaign is about Donald Trump, January 6th, abortion, the better it is for Democrats. It becomes a really a choice election instead of a referendum. And even if it is a referendum between Biden and Trump, that's probably pretty good for Democrats, not very good for Republicans.
So the White House may not have set out for this to happen.
Right.
They say
right.
They didn't know anything about this.
Yes. Right.
This FBI search, Tam, but it may turn out to be, because it elevates the former president, well, it may turn out to be something that works to their benefit.
Well, and I had been reporting even before all of this happened that President Biden had been mentioning Donald Trump's name more in his speeches. That, and you know, the take home from President Biden's pollster and from others that I talked to was, well, nothing motivates voters more than Donald Trump. Now, that's also true of Republican voters, but it's very true of Democratic voters. That said, President Biden and the White House are trying to put a focus on all of these things that they have actually accomplished,
right,
despite months of everyone assuming that there was no way that they would actually accomplish those things.
And let's be really clear, too. The reason that Donald Trump is in the spotlight is because Republicans are keeping him there. They very easily could have said, you know what, we should wait for more evidence. We should step back and let the department and the FBI do their job, and then we'll come out. But when you have the House Minority Leader immediately saying, when we take control of Congress, we're investigating this, and we're going to oust the Department of Justice, that's not sort of sitting back and letting the election be about anything else.
I mean, they said to the Attorney General, clear your calendar.
Yeah, exactly.
We're coming after.
Exactly.
But, Tam, what about this, though? You mentioned the Democrats. Now they have something they can talk about.
Yeah.
The Inflation Reduction Act passed. Is that something that could work to their benefit? Is it something that voters can hang on to?
I saw this ad today that Raphael Warnock put out, the senator from Democratic senator from Georgia, all about the burn pit legislation. That's bipartisan legislation. It's focused on something that people care about, veterans care about. You have now any number of pieces of legislation that senators can put out ads about. Progressive senators can say, look, we've done something about climate change. This is the most sweeping climate change. Other progressive candidates can say, look at this gun legislation. Yes, it was less than we wanted, but this gun legislation actually accomplished something. So they have things to point to. And again, going back to the president's pollster, he said, you know, like 2 months ago, they didn't have that many things to point to. Now they do.
Can it make a difference?
I would say the thing that has made the most difference and probably is helping Democrats the most is the fact that gasoline has gone down $1 since the beginning of this summer. And that is the pinch that people are feeling is a little bit less. We're seeing a little bump right now in consumer confidence. And for people who aren't feeling quite as pinched in their day-to-day expenses, although inflation still is taking a big bite, and I do think that still is going to be a big, big, big issue in the 22 midterms.
The inflation numbers seem to be easing off, but in terms of what people are seeing
and feeling,
a difference in feeling, it's the gas pump, it's the grocery store. Yeah.
And of course, there are a lot of Republicans who wish they could just focus on that and not Trump.
Right. But we keep talking about these other things, don't we?
Here we go.
Tamara Keith, Amy Walter, thank you both.
You're welcome. Okay.
As students and teachers across the country prepare to head back to school, the CDC is relaxing its COVID-19 guidelines. It's a significant shift in how the United States has approached the pandemic. Stephanie Tsai explains.
Judy, the latest guidance from the CDC prioritizes keeping kids in class and relaxes COVID prevention measures for people of all ages. Here's some of what's changed. If exposed to COVID-19, it's no longer necessary to quarantine. The CDC now says to wear a mask and get tested. If you test positive, the CDC recommends masking for 10 days, but says isolation can end after day 5. If symptoms are improving. What's more, the CDC also no longer recommends routine testing in K-12 schools unless community transmission is high. Not all health experts agree with the new CDC guidelines. For more, I'm joined by Julia Reifman. She's an assistant professor at Boston University School of Public Health. She also leads the COVID-19 U.S. state policy database, which tracks how states have responded to the pandemic. Julia Reifman, thank you so much for joining the NewsHour. The CDC has pointed to falling case numbers and hospitalizations, as well as to the fact that a lot of Americans now have some protection from COVID, either from the vaccine or having already gotten it. Do these new CDC guidelines get it mostly right or mostly wrong, in your view?
Thank you so much for having me. It's a pleasure to be here. So I think we should be looking to the CDC to set a high bar on evidence-based standards and standards that are equitable and inclusive. And so I think these guidelines could really be strengthened. We need leadership on helping people improve the use of all of the tools that we have to reduce COVID-19. What I would like to see is more of an emphasis on vaccine delivery at schools. Just about half of children are vaccinated at this point, so we really need increased vaccination coverage to help reduce preventable severe disease in kids. We also see that vaccines alone are not enough to reduce high transmission. And schools are places we really value. They're crowded indoor settings where we require students to go, and we want them to be safe for students, especially when there are surges. So what we really want to see more of is more preparedness to reduce the harms of surges, which will hit schools first and most because they are crowded indoor settings. What that would look like would be mask mandates that turn on at the beginning of a surge. What that would look like would also be increasing that vaccination coverage and booster coverage before the surge hits, and then increases in testing and supplies, as well as remote options for people who are high risk when there is very high transmission.
Some health experts say the new guidelines recognize that the best place for children is in the classroom and that this can be done safely with acceptable levels of risk. Would you agree with that?
You know, I think it is important to keep schools open and safe. So we really want to have them be healthy places that lead students in caring about their own health and that of one another and their families and their teachers. And so we see that safety guidelines like mask mandates have actually been a great help in helping students stay in school and reducing student and teacher absences. And so having a plan in place to acknowledge that the pandemic and its harms continue, but that we can mitigate them with sensible strategies that are not all or nothing, but that really respond to big surges and prepare for them, can really help students stay in school in a way that has a lot less transmission than the prior year.
And there still are about, on average, 500 people dying a day of COVID-19 in the United States. Which groups continue to be the most vulnerable? And we're not just talking about children here. They tend to be less vulnerable to severe disease.
Yeah, thank you for asking that question. 500 deaths a day is a lot of death. At one point, the federal government had talked about setting a goal of about 200 deaths a day. And we expect that number of deaths per day to increase during the school year as people go back into crowded indoor settings, as there may be seasonal surges or surges of new variants. So I think that number is too high a level to accept. And we see that there are large disparities by race, ethnicity, by income, and that people who are at high risk of severe COVID, people who are disabled, are at elevated risk of death and other severe outcomes due to COVID. And so that's why it is important to take mitigation steps, like implementing mask mandates at the beginning of surges to reduce the amount that COVID spreads, and reducing cases also reduces hospitalizations and deaths. It also reduces disruption to education, and parents who are missing work because they are staying home with kids who are sick or because they themselves become sick.
Overall, do you feel that these new CDC guidelines are science-based, or do you think that there are other factors at play that have changed the guidance?
You know, I think we have to recognize that public health is political and that both science and politics are reflected in these guidelines. And politics are part of the reason that the United States has not had a stronger response to COVID. The United States is number one in the death rate for Delta and Omicron relative to other high-income countries. So that really suggests that we need to do better. What is in the guidelines is an opportunity for schools and leaders to lead on better. We need layered mitigation. We need much better vaccination coverage for kids and for educators and for families. We also need mask mandates and surges and surveillance testing and surges.
Julia Reifman with Boston University School of Public Health, thank you for joining the NewsHour with your perspective.
Thank you so much for having me. It was a pleasure to be here.
And we'll be back shortly with a look at Salman Rushdie's career and fight for free speech. But first, take a moment to hear from your local PBS station. It's a chance to offer your support, which helps to keep programs like ours on the air. For those stations staying with us, coral reefs around the world are in growing danger due to rising temperatures connected with climate change. But in Florida and the Caribbean, marine biologists are racing to fight a new deadly threat. Science correspondent Miles O'Brien has our encore report.
I've been scuba diving in Florida and the Bahamas for 35 years. Which makes me an eyewitness to a slow-motion disaster. Marine biologist Karen Neely is also saddened by what she sees.
I know what it's like to go somewhere where you've had old friends and they're not there anymore. That's what we're seeing on the reefs here. Over the last 20 years has just been the continued loss of coral.
It's a global problem brought on by pollution, overfishing, and the climate crisis. The Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change predicts up to 90% of tropical coral reefs will vanish as soon as 2030 unless drastic action is taken to limit greenhouse gases. Grim as that is, here in Florida, things are worse. Neely is on a mission to stop a deadly coral epidemic decimating reefs here and throughout the Caribbean. First identified near Miami in 2014, stony coral tissue loss disease spreads and kills like wildfire. It strikes more than 20 of the 60 or so species of coral that live here.
It's heartbreaking. It's just unbelievable.
Marine biologist Valerie Paul is head scientist at the Smithsonian Marine Station at Fort Pierce. She is helping lead the urgent hunt for answers.
When we started, we didn't know anything. We just knew it was killing coral tissue, right? We know more than we did a few years ago, but we surely don't know enough.
Corals are complex, fragile, and poorly understood animals. They survive thanks to a mutually beneficial or symbiotic relationship with algae that live in coral tissue. In this marriage, the coral is the homemaker and the algae brings home the bacon. Actually, nutrients derived from photosynthesis. Many of the vivid colors of coral are actually created by the algae. So white patches are signs of disease or death.
So really this whole piece is diseased at this stage. This is fairly advanced disease on this coral.
But no one knows what sort of pathogen is at work. It could be viral or bacterial, or perhaps some combination. Here, they isolated a beneficial bacterium that fights off the disease.
We started just testing it in the laboratory first in various aquarium studies with pieces of diseased coral and saw that it would slow down the disease or stop it entirely. So this was like, wow, this is cool.
So they're treating healthy corals with probiotics applied beneath a weighted bag. It looks promising, but it's still early. Antibiotics are also working. Karen Neely is part of a small team of researchers applying amoxicillin paste to ailing corals. Her team from Nova Southeastern University and others have collectively saved nearly 15,000 corals. Still, the researchers are well aware they're only making a small dent in a massive problem.
We really have to be quite selective. We're figuring out what can we save, what might be okay if we can't get to it, and what are we going to lose regardless, and trying to get the most bang for the buck.
At the Florida Aquarium Coral Conservation Center near Tampa, they are fighting this disease on land.
So this is a tank of corals that are going to be going out into the ocean in a couple of weeks.
Carrie O'Neill is the senior coral scientist here. She wondered if she could make endangered pillar corals happy enough to reproduce. Something like that had never been done before with Florida corals in aquariums.
So you have to get all the seasonal cues right. The change in temperature, the change in daylight, sunrise, sunset, the moon phase. All of these different cues have to be just right in order for that one event to occur around the full moon of August.
The spawning happened on their first try in August of 2019.
We were just cheering and yelling and calling everybody, like, come in, we need help. and it's happened all, like clockwork every year since then.
So what started as a gene bank 5 years ago is now a huge, thriving coral breeding center. Carrie O'Neill occasionally joins divers from the Florida Fish and Wildlife Conservation Commission as they cement their offspring onto ailing reefs. Eventually, O'Neill hopes they will find the genes that make coral resistant and selectively breed animals that are immune to stony coral tissue loss disease. But remember, the disease is just one of many threats.
We cannot save coral reefs without stopping climate change and cleaning up our environment. That takes time. In the meantime, we need to ensure that we don't lose the diversity that we have now, so that we can build back the population. Our work here is buying us time.
When Karen Neely swims past healthy corals that she has treated, she feels the same way.
I definitely don't feel like it's a futile effort, and I do feel like we have to do something. If you like seafood, you like coral reefs. If you like vacationing in Florida, you like coral reefs. You might not know it, but it's super important that we have them, and it's pretty problematic when we lose them. I think in my lifetime, we will either start to see the swing back towards more healthy reefs, or we'll see reefs continue to decline into something almost unrecognizable.
Imagine that, a world without thriving coral reefs. Not a pretty thought. It's heartbreaking to watch it happening right before my eyes. For the PBS NewsHour, I'm Miles O'Brien, 30 feet beneath the surface at Lou Key, Florida.
Three days after being repeatedly stabbed on stage as he was preparing to give a lecture, author Salman Rushdie is recovering. But his agent says he suffered liver damage and is likely to lose an eye. The man accused of attacking him has been charged with attempted murder. Jeffrey Brown speaks with a fellow author and friend of Rushdie's.
Salman Rushdie, the man and the writer and the wider impact of the attack against him. Joining me now is Ayed Akhtar. He's a Pulitzer Prize-winning playwright and novelist. He's also the current president of the free speech organization Pan America, a position previously held by Salman Rushdie himself. And Ayed Akhtar, thank you for joining us. Salman Rushdie is your friend, I know, but you've also told me that he's a role model. Tell me what he is for you. What do you see in him?
Well, I grew up in a Muslim family. And, you know, when Salman wrote the Satanic Verses in 1988 and in 1989, the fatwa came down and he was, price was put on his head by the Iranian government. It was a big event in my life, and it was a big event in my community's life and in my family's life. And that book had such a pivotal effect on my understanding of the force of literature, what writing could do, how it could question the most fundamental things you believed. And it could do so in a playful way, in a satirical way. It could do so in a brilliant way. And it could get you into a lot of trouble. Maybe that wasn't the part of it that was the role model, but it was such a powerful experience to read that book as a young person, a young writer, as a young Muslim, and it changed my life. And it really did shape so much of my body of work to come.
What larger story has he been telling in his writings, including in the Satanic Verses?
Well, as any great writer, truly great writer, he's been telling all kinds of different stories. But I think the essence of what is at the heart of Salman's body of work is the power of storytelling and the power of stories and narrative to shape countries, to shape histories, to shape a religion, a way of thinking for centuries. And one of the things that is so powerful about what Salman has done over the years is that he playfully, brilliantly questions and provokes and prods and tests to see whether or not those stories hold up.
You know, like you, I have been with him in formal and informal settings and typically seen little or no security. He made a decision about how he was going to live his life.
I haven't spoken to him extensively about it, but it was clear that at a certain point, Salman believed that, you know, he couldn't, you know, he'd spent almost a decade in hiding, and it had taken a toll. He wrote about it very eloquently in his memoir, Joseph Anton. And there was a moment at which he decided it was time to live. It was time to go back to life.
I referred to the work that he's done at Pan America that you're doing now, and the other ways that he's worked in the area of freedom of expression. This became important to him, clearly, especially after his own experience?
Yeah, I mean, I think understanding, you know, Penn stood up for him very powerfully at the time. And, you know, who would understand better the consequences of freedom of expression than Salman Rushdie because of what happened to him? You know, I think it's such an important reminder to all of us that the freedom to think and the freedom to express that thought has to be a paramount value in our society, even beyond the so-called harms of speech, you know, because of course there are many people around the world who believe that Salman has harmed them in writing the Satanic Verses, but that can't stand alongside the claim that he has the freedom to say and to write what he must.
Well, what about the cause of expression now? I mean, why does this attack matter in a larger sense? What do you see?
I think increasingly, you know, we're seeing a diminished support for the freedom of expression and increased concern about the harms that speech can bring. And so on some level, there's a larger conversation about controlling speech or controlling what it is that's acceptable to say. And there are lots of avenues by which that's happening. This is a really clear reminder that debate is secondary, ultimately, to the freedom to express. Even Salman, I think, once said, if I don't have the freedom to offend you, then it isn't really freedom of expression.
You told me you've got a quote from Salman Rushdie that you thought was appropriate.
Yeah.
You want to read that?
Yes. Yeah. So this is Salman. A poem will not stop a bullet. A novel cannot defuse a bomb. But we are not helpless. The battle is not only on the battlefield. Even after Orpheus was torn to pieces, his severed head floating down the river, singing, reminding us that song is stronger than death. We can emulate Orpheus and sing on and not stop singing until the tide turns and a better day begins.
All right. We all want to send our best to Salman Rushdie. Ayad Akhtar, thank you very much.
Thank you, Jeff.
And we thank you, Ayad Akhtar and Jeffrey Brown, for that conversation. And that's the NewsHour for tonight. I'm Judy Woodruff. Join us online and again here tomorrow evening for all of us at the PBS NewsHour. Thank you. Please stay safe, and we'll see you soon.
Major funding for the PBS NewsHour has been provided by
For 25 years, Consumer Cellular's goal has been to provide wireless service that helps people communicate and connect. We offer a variety of no-contract plans, and our U.S.-based customer service team can help find one that fits you. To learn more, visit consumercellular.tv.
The Candida Fund, committed to advancing restorative justice and meaningful work through investments in transformative leaders and ideas. More at CandidaFund.org. Supported by the John D. and Catherine T. MacArthur Foundation, committed to building a more just, verdant, and peaceful world. More information at MacFound.org. And with the ongoing support of these institutions. This program was made possible by the Corporation for Public Broadcasting and by contributions to your PBS station from viewers like you. Thank you. This is the PBS NewsHour from WETA Studios in Washington and in the West from the Walter Cronkite School of Journalism at Arizona State University.
You're watching PBS.